Hello, welcome to Shaders Monthly. Today we're going to talk about something happening in your real or virtual camera called perspective projection. Because a lens makes the mathematical model of a camera more complex, we remove it from our model. We replace the lens with a small pinhole. When the size of the pinhole approaches zero, we arrive at the mathematical model of an ideal pinhole camera. For such a pinhole camera, all incoming light that reaches the image plane at the back of the camera must travel exactly through the pinhole. In the image plane of the camera, we can observe a flipped image of the object. In the mathematical model, we can avoid the flip by placing the virtual image plane in front of the pinhole. The location of the pinhole is also called center of projection. The most important parameter of a pinhole camera and its perspective projection is the field of view. The field of view is the opening angle of the camera. A wide-angle camera has a large opening angle and a telephoto camera has a small opening angle. Another important parameter is the aspect ratio of a camera. The aspect ratio is the ratio of the width and the height of the image. For example, a typical aspect ratio of a TV screen is 16 by 9. If you divide 16 by 9, you can also express the aspect ratio as a single floating point number. In this example, 1.7 recurring. Let's have a look at the basic equations for perspective projection. The camera's center of projection is located at the origin of the coordinate system. In OpenGL, the camera is looking in negative z direction. If you look through the camera, the y-axis points up and the x-axis goes to the right in the image plane. The red point is a 3D point and the green point is the corresponding projected point in the image plane. Now we look onto the y-z plane for this setup. The opening angle theta corresponds to the field of view in the y direction. The size of the image plane in the y direction is fixed to be exactly in the range minus 1 to 1. For a varying opening angle theta and a fixed size of the image plane, we like to compute the distance from the center of projection to the image plane. We call this distance focal length and denote it with a small f. A wide-angle camera has a large opening angle and a small focal length. A telephoto camera has a small opening angle and a large focal length. From the figure we can see that the ratio of the focal length to 1 equals the ratio of cosine to sine of the half angle. Consequently, the focal length is equal to the cotangent of the half angle. Given a point capital P in 3D space with 3D coordinates capital X, Y, Z, we want to compute the corresponding y-coordinate of the projected point in the image plane. From the intercept theorem, we know that the ratio of this y-coordinate to the focal length is equal to the ratio of capital Y to capital Z of the 3D point. If we multiply both sides of the equation with f, we arrive at the fundamental equation for perspective projection. The y-coordinate in the image plane equals the focal length times capital Y divided by capital Z. Note that I have put minus Z in the equation. This is because our camera is looking in the negative Z direction. Therefore, all points in front of the camera have a negative Z coordinate. Consequently, if we want the focal length to be a positive value, we have to divide Y by the negative Z value for the shown configuration. Our derivation in the YZ plane can also be applied in the XZ plane and we get the same result. The X coordinate in the image plane equals the focal length times capital X divided by capital Z. These two equations for the X and Y coordinate of a two-dimensional projected point are rather simple. However, in the OpenGL pipeline, we are not only interested in the X and Y coordinate, but we also need a Z coordinate to perform the depth test. Furthermore, 3D transformations and the perspective projection are typically performed in projective space, where 3D points are represented as 4 vectors and transformations are 4x4 matrices. Therefore, we first need to talk about Euclidean space and projective space. The three-dimensional Euclidean space is the one familiar to us, where a 3D point can be expressed by three Cartesian coordinates, capital X, Y, Z. In contrast, a 3D point in projective space has an additional fourth coordinate. Thus, a 3D point in projective space is represented as a 4 vector. To map a 3D point from Euclidean space to projective space, we can simply set the additional fourth coordinate to 1. To map a 3D point from projective space to Euclidean space, we have to divide the first three coordinates by the last coordinate, which is denoted here as W. Coordinates in projective space are scale invariant. This means that you can scale the vector by any factor lambda and the vector still represents the same 3D point. We can easily verify that this is true by mapping the scaled vector from projective space to Euclidean space. We see that the factor lambda is cancelling out. Because four vectors with different scales can represent the same 3D point, the coordinates in projective space are called homogeneous coordinates. You know this slide already from the previous episode. It shows the different steps of the OpenGL pipeline. Input to the OpenGL pipeline are 3D vertices. For each vertex, a vertex shader is executed in parallel. The task of the vertex shader is to perform per vertex operations. For example, the transformation of each vertex from the local coordinate system of the mesh into the coordinate system of the camera, as well as the projection into the image plane of the camera. This projection is exactly what we discussed today. As we will see, these transformations are typically performed in projective space by multiplying four vectors with 4x4 matrices. We have also learned in the last episode that every vertex shader has a predefined compulsory VEC4 output variable called GLPosition. The fact that GLPosition has four coordinates indicates that it is not given as an Euclidean 3D point, but as a 3D point in projective space. So let's have a closer look at the next step of the pipeline and see what operations are performed in the per vertex post-processing step. The first operation is 3D clipping. The next operation is called perspective division. Here, the OpenGL pipeline divides the first three coordinates of each vertex by the fourth coordinate. As we have learned on the previous slide, this is exactly the operation that maps a 3D vertex from projective space to a 3D vertex in Euclidean space. So the perspective division is something that is done automatically by the OpenGL pipeline, and that is why we do not have to perform this division in our vertex shader code. The coordinates after the perspective division step are in Euclidean space. They are called normalized device coordinates. This is because the resulting x, y, and z coordinates are all normalized to be within the range minus 1 to 1. 3D vertices outside of this minus 1 to 1 range are automatically clipped by the preceding clipping step. The last operation in the per vertex post-processing step is the viewport transformation. The 2D viewport transformation maps the coordinates from normalized device coordinates to window coordinates. The viewport transformation can be freely chosen. Typically, it maps the x-coordinate from range minus 1 to 1 to the width of the output frame buffer and the y-coordinate from range minus 1 to 1 to the frame buffer's height. After the viewport transformation, the x and y-coordinate have the unit pixels, which is important for the succeeding rasterization step. For each pixel of a rasterized primitive, a fragment shader is executed in parallel. The task of the fragment shader is to compute an output color. But before the color is written to the frame buffer, the fragment must pass several tests. For example, if the depth test is enabled, the color is only written to the frame buffer if the current fragment is closer to the camera than previous fragments written to the same pixel location. This is why the z-coordinate of the normalized device coordinates is very important. The rasterizer interpolates this per-vertex z-coordinate for each fragment, such that a per-fragment depth test can be performed. Consequently, in OpenGL, a perspective projection is not a mapping of a 3D point to a 2D point in the image plane, but instead it's a mapping from one 3D space into another 3D space. The field of view in Y direction and the image plane define a viewing pyramid in 3D space that is truncated by two planes to generate a viewing frustum in 3D. These two planes are called the near and the far plane, and they are defined by their distance to the center of projection. All 3D points within the viewing frustum must be mapped to normalized device coordinates after perspective projection and after the perspective division step. This target space, representing the normalized device coordinates, is visualized here as a yellow cube, for which all coordinates are in the range -1 to 1. Note that the z-axis of the target space is inverted and is pointing in the view direction of the camera. A point on the far plane should be mapped to z equals 1 in normalized device coordinates. And a point on the near plane should be mapped to z equals -1. In projective space, a 3D point is represented as a 4 vector. Therefore, a mapping from a 3D point to another 3D point is performed by mapping a 4 vector to another 4 vector. If this mapping is linear, it can be performed by multiplication with a 4x4 matrix. Let's have a look at the 4x4 matrix that is generated by a function called GLUPerspective from the OpenGL utility library. It has 4 floating point parameters: the field of view in Y direction, the aspect ratio, the distance of the near plane, and the distance of the far plane. The 4x4 matrix shown here is created. Now let's check if this matrix fulfills our requirements. Capital X, Y, Z are the Cartesian coordinates of the 3D point. To represent it in projective space, we set the fourth coordinate to 1. Now we multiply this point with the generated 4x4 matrix and check the result. This is the result in projective space. If we apply the perspective division to go back into Euclidean space, we get this 3 vector. For the y coordinate, we have exactly the results that we want. The y coordinate in the image plane equals the focal length times capital Y divided by capital Z. Same for the x coordinate, but we see an additional factor for the aspect ratio here. For the y coordinate, this factor is not needed because the field of view is given in y direction. Therefore, the resulting coordinates are already in range -1 to 1 because we computed the focal length accordingly. But for the x dimension, we need the additional factor of 1 over aspect to map the x coordinates to the range -1 to 1. Now for the z coordinate, the requirement was that a point on the far plane maps to z equals 1. If we put in capital Z minus far into the equation, we see that minus z and far are cancelling out. 2 times near minus near equals near. Then we have near minus far in the numerator, which is the same as the denominator, and the term is equal to 1. Perfect. Furthermore, the requirement was that a point on the near plane maps to z equals -1. If we put in capital Z equals minus near into the equation, we see that minus z and near are cancelling out. 2 times far minus far equals far. Now remains far minus near in the numerator, and the total term is equal to -1. Excellent, this matrix from the GLU perspective function achieves what we want. All points from the viewing frustum are mapped to normalized device coordinates. 3D points outside of the viewing frustum are clipped by the OpenGL pipeline. After all this theory, let's implement the perspective projection in our shader. To this end, we open the torus knot example from episode number 1 in the GSN Composer. The link is provided in the video description. Let's first press the play button to see the output of this example. We see a torus knot, and the normal direction of the surface defines the output color for each fragment. We select the shader node and press the Edit Code button. In the top section, we see the vertex shader, and in the bottom section, the fragment shader code. In the last episode of Shaders Monthly, we already discussed the difference between variables with the in qualifier and the uniform qualifier. In variables change per vertex. In contrast, uniform variables are constant for all vertices of the draw call. Because we want to define a projection matrix that is the same for all vertices of the mesh, we can pass it to the shader as a uniform variable. Uniform mat for projection. Then we multiply the 4x4 matrix with our vertex positions given as a 4-vector in projective space. Furthermore, I define an additional uniform variable to move the mesh into negative z direction. Uniform float offset z. Apply code and close. As we see, the GSN Composer has created two new input slots for our new uniform variables. Now, let's create the 4x4 perspective matrix. Press Create and navigate to Matrix, Compute, Transformation, Perspective. The Perspective node has four inputs: Field of View, Aspect, Near Plane and Far Plane. So this is exactly the same as the GLU perspective function in the slides. To see the values of the 4x4 matrix, I press Create and navigate to Matrix, Compute, Convert, to Text. Remember that blue compute nodes and green data nodes need to alternate in the graph. Therefore, we connect the green matrix node to the input of the toText node. Furthermore, we connect the green matrix data node to the projection slot of our shader node. Okay, great, we get some output from the shader. Now I select the shader node and change the offset z to a negative value. This moves the object in minus z direction away from the camera, because the camera is looking in the negative z direction. Did you notice that we now also have a blue component in the colors? This is because the positive z direction of the surface normals is now pointing in the direction of the camera. We can also select the perspective node and change the field of view, or the aspect ratio. Let's set the aspect ratio to 17:9, which is equal to 1.7 recurring. The output is squeezed in the x direction. So we select the shader node and change the size of the frame buffer to 1920x1080 to get the correct aspect. I can also change the near plane of the perspective projection. We can observe that the parts outside of the viewing frustum are clipped. The same happens if I change the far plane. Excellent, it seems like everything is working as expected. Okay, that's it for today. All links are provided in the video description. Also, C++ and Java examples, which use the same shader code, are available. The C++ and Java source code can be exported in the shader editor of the GSN Composer. I hope that in this video I have provided all the required information about perspective projection and its application in a shader. If not, please use the comments or get in contact with me.